We're going to go through step by step how you insert a table of contents with page numbers or with links, and how you get it to format right with the indentations in the different sections. So the easiest part, the first thing that you do, is you just go to Insert Table of Contents. And both of these are going to function exactly the same way as far as how we put them together. So for now, I'm just going to choose with page numbers. And at the end, I'll show you the links as well. And just there are a couple nuances about that. So I just inserted a table of contents. And this entire area around inside the border is made dynamically. So you're not really supposed to edit this, but it's produced from the formatting below. So how we're going to look at how this became the way it is with the sections here, subsections here, and the page numbers. The best way to look at that is that we're going to look at the document outline. So go to Tools and go to Document Outline. And this is going to show you where your title is and where your headers, where your heading 1 and heading 2 are. What I'm talking about is this line is formatted. The style is title. Table of contents don't pick up titles. That's why it's not up here. The next one is formatted as a heading 1. Table of contents is going to pick that up. And so is this section and this section. But if you go down to where these are indented and you look at the table of contents as well, they're indented. I didn't do that by creating a table of contents and then hitting tab. Table of contents does that automatically, because if I go down the kind replenish, it's a heading 2. So if I make it a heading 3, you'll see it indents even further. Go back up to the table of contents and you have to refresh it. So click in here and click the refresh button and it indents it even further. So if you just made a table of contents and you couldn't figure out why it looks so random, it's because it's being driven by the formatting. So let's go back down the kind replenish, make it a heading 2. It'll bring it back to where it was before. And if you want to make this look like a regular table of contents that you would find, I would probably insert a page break right after it. And you can even title it Table of Contents, but you'll see I put that above the actual table of contents, so it's not in the bordered area. But you can also format items in the table of contents if you want to. It's probably best practice to format it right in your document so it gets picked up. But if you left click on it and you hit change, you actually can change the name of the header here. Let's see, if I take that period off and I hit apply, it doesn't actually change the document. So you can customize your table of contents. It also made that a link, which I didn't want it to, so just hit remove. So that brings us to the second type of table of contents that we can do, which is, let's just delete this one first. So let's just get rid of the entire table of contents by right-clicking, doing delete table of contents. And I'm going to insert this page break again. I'll show you how you can insert a table of content with links. And there's just a couple things that work strangely about this. I'm in editing mode. You see that in the upper right-hand corner. And if I go into the table of contents, though, these links don't work. You can't click on them. It's because it still thinks you're creating the table of contents. So you can change or remove it, but you can't actually click on it. But if you share this with someone else in a view-only format, when they get this document and they're viewing it, they'll be able to navigate. So if you click on one of the lines, I had to double click that time, it'll go down to that header. So the table of contents with links is probably more useful if you think other people are going to be viewing this online. Table of contents with the page numbers is more helpful if you're going to distribute this in paper.